Chris Riley for inviting me to get this talk in this great institution. In the next few minutes, I'm going to share with you the topic. I think it is just a very brief topic, according to the title, when to initiate. And I think you know from the start when to initiate new models and innovations with chronic kidney disease. Actually, I gave this talk two times before, but this time I think that I find it like very, very. I have the privilege actually to make this talk here at this institution to clarify something about the when to initiate, because there is too much debate. Although it has been established in the guidelines, but it's your clinical judgment and your opinion, physician opinion is very important actually, and when to start or when to initiate that, or what you call it in the nephrology term, time of that. For the sake of the time, I'm going to jump very quickly about my agenda, like overview about the when to start and timing and initiation of dialysis. Actually, this is not my task, patient education, vascular dialysis, but I can just give very brief notes about like a summary of what my respected professor mentioned in the previous lectures. And finally, I will just conclude and give you a take-home message regarding what I said. Regarding initiation of hemodialysis, what's been established in the guidelines and the current Bratz guidelines that we all know, I think we will follow, is the KDOQI that we all know. From these guidelines, I just give you just 1 minute actually to read what this pyramid means. This is telling you about the grid of evidence that we just listed every day, grid 1, B, A, B, C. Just if we take it from the bottom to the top. If we take grid C, which is just the data of the grid C, it's been extrapolated from just background information and expert opinion. If we go higher, we go to the grid B, which is extrapolated from the case control studies or cohort studies or randomized controlled trials. And then if we go higher for the grid A, I think the data will be extrapolated from more and more sophisticated studies like critically appraised individuals or critically appraised topics or systemic reviews like Cochrane's or big meta analysis, which give you the strength of the evidence. Just when I mentioned actually because I know just to mention A, B, C, so you know what I'm telling actually when I say A, B, C. This is from the extrapolated from the guidelines, from the KDOQI guidelines, and when to be, I mean how to prepare the patient for hemodialysis. Just very briefly, what is the patient in the stage of 4? I mean, GFR less than 30 milliliters per minute. Patient should receive, which is very important, because I'm not talking about it, about the education. It's very important. I'm not talking just extensively about that, but just highlight only. And the option of treatment has to be explained to the patient in terms of either hemoperitoneal dialysis or the other modality, which is transplantation, of course. And the patients, they can be considered as like indicator for the patient, or the caregiver, like a nurse, like a doctor, can give that such a job for the patient. And you can see it just with a moderate stress of evidence B. Just when to initiate hemodialysis, you have to have, I mean, like one surrogate type of how to estimate GFR, how to estimate the renal function. It's very important, actually, which kind, just to follow creatinine, or to follow like other formulas that you all know. I think you all know that the MVRD or Kirchhoff-Rothenberg formula now has like one of the good standard methodology for estimating the GFR. It's very easy and cheap method just to calculate, just depending on just simple variables like serum creatinine or body weight, age of the patient, gender, like that. So it's very important actually and very one of the essentials to know. I think you have it at online access. It's very easy to get it. And measurement of the urea and creatinine clearance also has big faults related, just depending on the age, depending on the gender, muscle mass, and so forth. And you cannot rely on the serum creatinine itself or the urea itself on estimating the GFR. Regarding the timing of the therapy, it's very important. When the patient reached stage of 5, or I mean KD, CKD 5, with the GFR less than 15, nephrologist should evaluate the benefit and the risk and disadvantage of beginning dialysis replacement. And you have to be very wise actually when just to decide who to. I mean, the patient is very healthy and he has nothing, he has no complaint, he's just by chance you find that accidentally the serum creatinine is, for example, 7 or 8, and when you just calculate the GFR, you find it like 14 or 15 or even 10, but the patient is still very healthy. So what can you do? And just ask the audience if you just decide the analysis or to wait or... Wait. To wait. To follow up the patient and give them conservative treatment and so forth. Right. Okay. Well, this is very important actually. If I find the patient in that good health and there is no, I mean, urgent indication to do dialysis, well, I can wait what's wrong and just wait up to what? Up to when? Until the patient comes to you with urgent indication for hemodialysis or to have a plan. I mean, Can somebody tell me? Okay, I think from the clinical practice here, we can wait, but we'll see. And I'm just waiting, the serum creatinine is jumping, is rising progressively, then I can decide to do dialysis. But if it's very slowly, I can just wait and see what's going on. الحقيقة طبعاً in actual fact according to the guidelines, we follow the guidelines and you can even start earlier before 15 milliliters per minute in certain institutions, like for example diabetic nephropathy, we will just go earlier to start dialysis because of vascular complication is very prominent in patients with diabetes. That's why let's start earlier in patients with diabetes, or any patient with other vascular problem, for example, cardiovascular problem. However, this study, which being published very recently in 2010, was talking about the time of dialysis. This study actually was a retrospective study, was carried out in the States, a multi-center study around 1 million patients of hemodialysis from 1995 up to 2006. They classified the patient according to the GFR into four groups. Patient who started dialysis earlier, more than 15 milliliters per minute, and patient from 15 to 10, and patient from 10 to 5, and patient less than 5. And they followed up the consequences and comorbidity and mortality and morbidity in such patient, and the results were surprising actually. And the conclusion was the late initiation of dialysis, I think you can see here. You can find just the conclusion. And the late initiation of dialysis was associated with this morbidity and mortality. So this is a big study actually, 1 million patients. But the patient with the late initiation of dialysis has like a good prognosis, and they didn't show any kind of morbidity or mortality. So they behaved very well, more than the patient, they started dialysis earlier. So we can follow this study. It is a very bigger trial and the biggest study actually to follow. And I think KDOKI and the other guidelines or KDGO will just look at this study and maybe address their guidelines when they just issue next guidelines for initiation of hemodialysis. And this actually is a Kaplan-Meier curve regarding the survival of such patients. and you could find the survivor was more or superior in patients who started dialysis at GFR less than 5 millimeter per minute, while those who started dialysis earlier were associated with more morbidity and mortality. Another study was published in New England Journal of Medicine in 2010. This was a prospective randomized controlled trial talking about which is better, early or late dialysis, early versus late initiation of dialysis. And similarly, they conclude that planned early initiation of dialysis in patients with stage 5 or CKD5 chronic kidney disease was not associated with any improvement in the survival or clinical outcome. So these two studies, I think, they are going to change the this guideline regarding the initiation of dialysis. Just let me talk very briefly about my respected professors talk about just patient preparation for permanent for dialysis. And I think Dr. Rehab and Dr. Karkar talked extensively about it. And from the guidelines, what they said about the guidelines, from the clinical practice guidelines for vascular access, appropriate planning and help for initiation of dialysis therapy at appropriate time with permanent access in place at the start of dialysis therapy. As Dr. Ayman said, around 6 months to start, 6 months ahead before dialysis. I mean, if the patient reaches the stage of stage 4, less than 30 milliliters per minute, then the patient should be educated in all modalities of kidney replacements, including dialysis or kidney transplantation. And time referral also can be made for appropriate modality and placement of permanent dialysis access if necessary. This is very strong evidence. And in patients with chronic kidney disease 4 or 5, forearm and upper arm being suitable for placement of vascular access shouldn't be used. I think this is actually what we teach our nurses to do, not to do any mini puncture, not to get placement of intravenous access, whatever catheter or subclavian catheter or central line on the side that you are planning to go for fistula. So it's prohibitive to avoid vascular stenosis and venous hypertension on the long term. And peripherally inserted central catheter should be also avoided. Patients should have a functional permanent access at the initiation of dialysis therapy. It's very simple actually, just to start there. But the way how to just to give it to the patient, I think Dr. Sopra talked about how to do the talent that you have just to give it to the patient. I think, you can just choose whatever the way that you can convince your patient to do dialysis, to do any test of first. And similarly for transplant dialysis, should be placed at least 2 weeks before initiation of dialysis. And the decaster may be used as a bridge. If you have like failure of an access at all, just you don't have an access at all, so you can use the decaster like a bridge between the failure of the fistula to have another fistula. Regarding the evaluation of the access should be performed before placement of the permanent cut. Dr. Ehabsa talked about it, and we should just have an eye on the history and physical examination, doublet ultrasound, central vein evaluation is appropriate vein, known to have previous catheter or pacemaker. It's very important actually. And this actually is a table I'm not going to talk about that, which is just very long, but we'll give you a hint about the history and the other comorbid conditions and physical examinations before placement of vascular access. This guidelines are talking about the selection and placement of the hemodialysis access, the time and location of long-term hemodialysis access to optimize access survival and minimize complication. The access should be placed distally and in the upper extremity whenever possible, and options for testing and tracing should be considered first before anything. Testing as the first, for actual fact, followed by the graph, and finally followed by the central venous catheter, like permanent access or even temporary access. And actually, I just prefer, I like to have this slide actually, the choice of the kind of vascular access is like a perfect size. You go easily and you go safely with the fistula, and if not, the fistula is available, then you can go for arteriovenous graft, which is the yellow, and the red one to avoid is the long-term catheter. So the fistula is a natural and very safe thing just to start with. If not available, you can go for the heavy graft, and finally, if you don't have, there's no choice, then you go for permanent access. Better the vascular access, long-term catheter. So again, and this is the AV fistula, and this is the AV graft, so we have to play in real pictures, actually. And things, just to avoid, whenever possible, long-term catheter, which is very important. Non-carved tumoral catheter should be used in mid-count only. This is to just please don't leave the patient to go with the femoral catheter at home. Even sometimes actually we don't let the patient to go with central venous catheter like internal jugular unless we just go tie bandage and tell him instructions if there is anything happened, any complication, bleeding or something to report for his treating physician. And special attention should be paid to the consideration for avoiding femoral catheter access in hemodialysis patients who are current or future kidney transplant, because you know the toxocomotiliac as a feeding in here for the transplant visit. So it is very important to avoid puncturing the femoral vein to avoid any further future complication related to the graft. This is the central venous catheter, you know, and the last thing actually is patient should be considered for construction of a primary fistula after failure of every dialysis fistula. I think I gave you just, Dr. Rehab, just told you many options and many alternatives for the AV fistula, but the major foresight that we use is the distant, I mean, radiocephalic or brachiocephalic with two arms. So this is the four places, it fails, then we go for the graft. So failure of one fistula, you go for another fistula before proceeding to another sophisticated procedure. So finally, I just conclude and give you a take-home message from all decision actually. One of the key successes for dialysis is the preparation, either emotionally, financially, and physically. Very important, actually. And dialysis can be hard in each of these. However, with proper preparation, its impact can be least impression. The responsibility belongs to the patient as his most active participant. It's very important to convince and to make the patient a partner of the dialysis procedure, because he's the patient, he's the one who's gonna be relied upon, not anybody. So you have to explain everything. You have to share him with the procedure, not to just to tell him that you are going to go dialysis and you're gonna surprise by the machine and this. So you have to explain to him first. You have to convince him, you have to give him some sympathy to start the process very safely and very easily. And the better the prepared patient will be the best participant in the treatment and the more successful their treatment will be. Thank you so much for your attention.
Please, everyone. Dr.